07 Distractions, very nice. Yes, I approve of that, Carl. Good choice there. Now, Steve.
Yes.
Carl came round to my flat.
Mm.
It was Tuesday night, wasn't it?
Nice place.
Now, thanks. Now, last week after the show, I think you guys were in the time you were in the toilet. Right, Carl got out the lottery ticket that he bought. He went, I'm feeling really confident tonight.
Right.
He's going, I was going, I laughed. He went, no, seriously. He said, look at the numbers. And I looked at him and I think they were 4, 6, 8, 20, 36, 48, weren't they? He's going, I just got a feeling about those. I went, sure. He went, although, you know, my girlfriend said that, you know, if I won the lottery, we'd probably split up because we like such different things, meaning she likes to travel and he doesn't. And so he said, so what I said was, well, if I win, then I won't tell you. I'll just treat you a little bit more. Brilliant.
That's brilliant logic.
That is great. Anyway.
I'll look after her.
Oh, I imagine you take care of her, yeah. Yeah, yeah, you're a good guy. How would you do it then? You just sneak little gifts in slowly over many years.
Yeah.
You don't think she'd rumble the fact that you like don't work anymore and drive a Lamborghini?
Well, I'd still do this, I think.
What, just like as a kind of beard, as a cover story?
Yeah, just.
So you'd pretend to come to work, but maybe off partying and stuff in the daytime.
Yeah.
Clever.
Now, he didn't win.
Okay.
I phoned him up Saturday night. He went one number. one number. I think it was eight, wasn't it?
Yeah. There was a lot of eights on my piece of paper, weren't they? So I think it was either an 8 or an 18 or a 48.
And he was disappointed. He said, waste of time. I went, well, he said, no, waste of time. He said, I've worked it out. I went, go on. He went, there are 26 letters in the alphabet. I went, yeah. He went, think how many words you can make out of them. He went, there are 48 numbers on the lottery. I went, yeah, 60 million to one. He went, yeah.
I looked into that in the week, right? And there's even less letters in the Welsh alphabet. They've only got 20, and yet they've got loads of words as well. So even 20, the chances, if there was 20 numbers and you had to pick 6 winners, it'd still be really...
Unlikely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. You should be a mathematician. And anyway, so we got talking about it. We got talking, that was me, him and Jane around there. And I told Jane, that he said about, oh, if you won the lottery, you know, he didn't like travel. And she went, why don't you like travelling? And he went, well, I don't like planes. I'm really scared of planes and that. And she went, well, if you won the lottery, you could have a world cruise. And he went, no. She went, you don't fancy it? I went, no. He said, if you go on a world cruise, what do you do next year?
Oh, genius. It's brilliant logic, Carl.
It's
but you know, on the world cruise, you don't actually see the whole world. I mean, you.
And if you did, it's not like saying, well, I don't want to see that twice.
It is the world.
It is the world. It's a lot. It's a lot to see.
Mm. Did it never dawn on you before about the numbers and the lottery? Have you been playing this for years and thinking that you had a good chance? That it was just like you and a handful of other people that were doing it?
Just as much chance as everyone else, but then when you actually sit down and think about what you're doing.
He's done it again this week. He went, I'm doing it one more time, and he showed me the numbers and he went, they look a bit more healthy, don't they?
What numbers are you going for this week?
It's alright laughing, but we'll see you tonight.
Yeah. Go on then. You know people, if people do this and they win, if you take these out and people do these, you'll have to share it with someone. It's alright though, isn't it? Give them a chance. Give people a clue. What numbers are you doing, Carl?
No, I'm not going to tell them all. I'll give you four. I've got 5, 9, 12 and 26.
Okay.
You're not going to give us the other two?
No. Because that's a big difference, isn't it? Four's worth about 8 grand, isn't it? But if I give them the other two and it wins.
Yeah. What are those four numbers again?
5, 9, 12, 26.
Also, coming up is Carl's GCSE results. He took them in 1988, I think.
Was it?
And we've phoned his score, we tracked him down. We've got Carl's GCSE, what did I say?
How many did you get, Rick?
Clinic, walking with E. Sorry about that earlier. You know I like to keep a tight, slick ship, and that lets us all down, doesn't it? When something goes wrong with the shoddy equipment in this place.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't you buy some new stuff? You must be earning a bit of money now, wasn't you? We got a few listeners now, we get adverts, don't we? Why don't they just buy a new CD player? You can go down to Richer Sounds and get one for £50.
Yeah. I don't know. It's, I suppose, when you're starting off, you save the money you make first before you spend it.
Go down to Record and Tape Exchange, take all the four non-blondes and excess stuff you've got.
At the record library.
You'll be able to get an old CD player.
25 minutes this week it took.
Well, the four non-blondes obligatory mention.
I think we should make that some sort of call-in-to-win feature.
Carl, are we using the equipment that you used to use when you had Pilkey's Making Music, the DJ outfit that you
made? I love that. That was Karl Pilkington and someone making?
Colin Making.
Pilkey's Making Music.
Genius. Are we using that same equipment?
Did you earn any money?
I paid for the tube lights and that. I sort of covered my costs.
Did you? Did you pay tax on that?
And then, no. That's what they get Al Capone on, isn't it?
It is, yeah. That's right. Don't worry about the music policy. We're sorting that out. We've got some Verve coming up. We got some Jimmy Webb. We got some Nick Cave. We got some Amy Mann. We got some Travis Corner Shop. You know what I mean? We're sorting ourselves out. We haven't started yet. We're just starting getting going. We got Carl's GCSE result.
Let's just do it now.
Should we do it now?
Well, I think we should have a White Van Man session.
Oh, White Van Man.
I think people tune in for the White Van Man session.
Yeah, people who haven't tuned in, they don't know.
If people aren't familiar with this, The Sun runs a column every day, which is asking some punter from the street their views on the week's big events, and we just thought, why not hijack that idea, but apply it to Karl Pilkington. Carl?
I've seen much news again this week.
You've not seen much news. Don't worry, I'm sure you have an opinion on
just
it.
Just have you, just give us it from your heart.
So Gladiator.
Okay, so, well, on the subject of Gladiator, what do you make of Russell Crowe's appalling behaviour at the BAFTAs?
This is, I heard a bit about this. This is, when he got some director or something, because...
Director or producer and threatened him, because they cut his bit, didn't they?
They cut a poem that he'd done during the acceptance speech.
I watched it on Sunday night. Sure. I didn't realise it wasn't live, to be honest.
Yeah.
But I quite liked the way it was to the point and didn't mess about. It was, he went up, he said thanks.
So you're saying that he shouldn't have beaten up the director? Is that what you're basically saying?
It's a bit over the top.
You thought so?
I mean, if he didn't have time, if he really, I mean, what's the poem got to do with the film anyway? He was an award
So do you think it's ever justified to beat up a TV director if you're a major Hollywood star?
Depends what he's done, but I mean...
Right, what would he have to have done, Carl, for it to be fine for him to then beat him up?
The thing is, right, forget all the beating up. At the end of the day, it was a awards thing for a film. The poem had nothing to do with the film.
Yeah.
So go up, collect your award for that thing. And if he really, really wanted people to hear about this poem, he could have photocopied it and left it at the entrance and said, on your way out, this is a really nice poem, pick one up.
No, but the thing is... He knew it was televised, so he knew by saying that poem once, he was reaching 5 billion people. That's a lot of photocopies. Do you see what I'm saying? I'm not saying it was justified.
It wasn't a poem award. If it was an award show for poems, you'd say you can't cut it out. It'd be like doing the top 40 and then going, number one's good, but we haven't got time for it. But it's a films thing.
Okay.
And he went up and he got the award for the film. Which film was it for?
I don't know, but when I wanted to give you results... I said, let's give Carl his results. Steve went, no, we should introduce people to Carl again, just remind people what Carl's like. And he's so right. I'm so glad we did this first.
Am I right, though?
Carry on, Steve.
Okay, the next topic. What about this big debate over whether Kylie Minogue's had a bum job?
I'd have to see it.
Next!
Okay. What do you make of Will Young's single? He's the Pop Idol winner. It's gonna net record-breaking sales, apparently. It's gonna go straight to number one. He's had millions of copies sold.
I heard last week that you had to, if you wanted to buy it from Woolworths, you had to go in and put a pound down to guarantee you getting a copy.
Wow.
I think that's stupid.
But what do you make of it, though? Do you think,
As a song?
Both as a song, and are you excited about Will Young and his future?
No, he'll do all right. I don't think we have to worry about him.
Okay.
He'll do all right. It's not my thing, but he seems like a nice bloke.
Okay, good. Very good. One final one then. What do you make of our scientists getting the go-ahead to clone embryos for research? We have discussed cloning before, and obviously there's the pros and cons of that. Christopher Reeve, former Superman star, he's behind this. Are you behind him?
Yeah. I mean, with everything, you have your good and your bad, don't you?
Yeah.
At the end of the day. If you didn't have bad things in the world, then you wouldn't enjoy the good things. I think, you know, it's like if you didn't have robbers in the world, policemen wouldn't have a job. So it's the same thing. It's like, it's an illness. Yeah. So what are they messing with?
It's probably a bit too detailed to go into there, really, but,
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's good and bad. You can't have it all.
Yin and yang is what you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay, Carl, I can't argue with that, mate.
I want to play a track now that, I haven't heard for a while. It's The Verve, isn't it?
Yeah.
Sonnet. Lovely song.
Coming soon, those big exam results.
Black Rebel Motorcycle Club, spread your love, it's time to give Carl... You're actually nervous, aren't you? I'm a little bit nervous. Just to recap, Carl is 30 this year. He never went to get his results of his GCSEs. So myself and Steve took upon ourselves to phone his school, track them down, and we actually got your results. What did you think you took?
Did English.
Right.
Maths.
Yeah.
Art.
Right.
I think I did physics.
Okay. Well, you didn't do any of them.
Eh?
You didn't do any of them. You didn't register. You registered for one exam and took one exam and got results for one exam. So I don't know what you thought you were turning up to, or you weren't registered, or you didn't.
You're familiar with the notion of registering for an exam. You have to kind of officially register in order to be eligible.
What do you mean, register? I turned up for a couple.
Yeah, you can't just show up. You have to register for them.
You have to pay, because it costs the school money, so they have had to have paid for you if they thought you were going to pass. You can't just turn up on the day and ask for some paper at the front.
I never got a letter telling me that.
Well, that's because you were never at school.
But you did somehow register, or registered for one exam. You registered for history.
It's a topic that you've always been interested in.
Oh, I was saying to Ricky before, World War II, I loved it.
not, I mean, not the actual event,
no,
the study of it, you
all
mean.
The stuff, like, you know, about the Anderson shelters and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And the bombs and that.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I took it, it had nothing to do with that. It was more about the Tudors.
So it didn't, the Second World War didn't come up? You mean there were no questions about the Anderson shelters?
Nothing.
That's devastating.
So.
So well, what are you expecting the result to be?
Is that, seriously, is that it?
Yeah, it's the only one you took and registered.
As far
for.
As the school is concerned, or
yeah.
Certainly
it's
in terms
the only
of
one
what
that
they
counts.
Told us.
It's the only result, it's the only one that counts. Yeah, you've got...
I don't... Did you register for yours?
Yeah.
Yes.
I have, yeah, I've got certificates and everything.
So what, do you do that before the exam? Do you have to go somewhere and sign something, or...?
Yeah, you don't check your results and then decide if you want to register. It's not like Millionaire, when you look at the question and go, I think I'll take the money.
Yeah.
You go...
No,
but anyway, you must have registered for one, or maybe your teacher put it in. Put you
I
in for
well,
it.
I didn't do it.
So they must have been confident. They must have been confident. They must have thought your best bet was history.
Right. So, what did they get?
You got an E, which I think, I mean, technically, is a pass.
E.
It's a bad pass, but there's F and there's.
I mean, you're not going to be doing a PhD.
You can get an F, right, which is fail. And then a U, which is ungraded. Now, I don't know why the U exists, because F means you failed. U is like them going, you not only failed, but you wasted my time. We're annoyed that you took this exam.
So you thought they'd register me to get an E?
Well, they didn't.
Well, they
think
didn't.
You'd get
I think they were hoping. It was rather like you with the lottery. They were hoping for something better than
you
nothing.
See, I assume that the man who registered for that thought he can scrape an E if Anderson shout was come up.
Yeah.
Well, that's it. You've got... Now, what I'd like to do, Carl, is... I've started your re-education. You've read a book on Rasputin. I'll be asking you a few questions about that later. I've got another book for you to read next week. Next week,
I'm not in the mood.
What?
Not in the mood.
Oh, come on! Look! What's that? What does that say?
It's that fella... It's the picture of the bloke that he used to use for Citizen Smith.
Yeah? Che Guevara.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was quite happy, I think, when he found out that Robert Lindsay was involved. He went, yeah, of course you can. No worries, yeah.
What are your feelings, Carl?
What do you
think?
Are you depressed?
I'm just a bit annoyed, because I'm sure I turned up for more, so it just wasted me time.
Listen, yeah. They don't matter.
I'm sure
You're doing very well. You know, you can educate yourself. GCSEs are merely a step on the ladder to help you, not just for education, but, you know, they're more vocational than anything else. You're doing very well. And you're reading books. Don't worry about it.
It's not
a concern. But if you want, I'll pay for you to take history again.
Carl, we'd love to see you get a C or above.
And well, I'll pay for you and I'll get you some books. Right, now listen, listen, listen. We can, I reckon, when are the exams? June?
Something like that, yeah.
We're registered, we're trying to register next week, and I reckon you can get an A or B.
I'm busy.
No, don't worry about it, it's just easy. I'll get you Brodie's notes. If Heat magazine, they love you, Carl. They could probably sort something out. They could probably pay for a tutor. They got a lot of money, they sell a lot of magazines.
I mean, it is always, almost always, and you found that out, I discovered this, it's always the Tudors and Stuarts. There's no fear for that, them not coming up. Now, what do you know, what do you already know about them? You must know already know stuff about Henry VIII and Elizabeth.
No, because it just, it's too long ago to even get interested in. Do you know what I mean? You can't
is that why you didn't?
To it.
Okay.
The Anderson thing, it was like, God, you know, I bet my mum and dad were in an Anderson shelter. You know, this is interesting.
What, when they?
Oh, my granddad would have, like, had something to do with this. But the Tudors, it's like, I don't know even if they had a family back then.
By record, if we come back
hang
to
on,
this.
Hang
sorry,
on, hang
Steve,
on, I just, sorry, no, I just, because I need to introduce my new, the new feature.
Yeah,
for the
I
record.
Don't know if I had a family back then.
Carl, listen, let me just ask you now, right, if you can finish this sentence, we've got a chance. Divorce beheaded, died, divorce beheaded.
Died. What is it?
We just need to do a little bit of work, but otherwise I think you're going to be fine. It's how you remember what happened to Henry VIII's wives.
Their little...
Divorce beheaded, died, divorce beheaded.
It's like spam. Support, what is it? Support, protection, anchorage, movement. That's how
you're
going
to that's nothing to do with the Tudors.
No, that's to do with the skeleton.
Yeah, see, no, we're not doing biology.
Mnemonics and acronyms.
What happened to Henry VIII's last wife? Did she die or did she not die? Divorce beheaded, died, divorce beheaded.
Do you know that the only king that has got a moustache is... No. The only king that hasn't got a moustache is the King of Hearts on the playing cards.
What's the record you play?
I want to resurrect the career of a different artist each week. This is an artist who's overlooked by the general public.
It's a red card.
This is Amy Mann, and she always seems to get overlooked. This was a single a while back.
Well,
I think it's called Red Vines. Play it, Carl.
Fantastic.
You see, what upsets me is the way that Amy Mann, yeah. She's written songs as good as that, she's yes. released it as a single, she had to, I think, put the album from which that's taken out by herself over the internet, she was Oscar nominated yes. for the songs in the film Magnolia, she couldn't get a record label, I don't know if she's now got one, and yet there's people like Alanis Morissette shifting
that is
shed loads
beautiful.
Of songs. I don't understand
fantastic.
What the rules are, I don't know why she's not a household
Carl,
name.
Well, there's
what?
Beautiful things like that in the world, why do you care about epoxy
well,
GCSE?
What did she get for history?
What did she get for history?
Yeah.
I think she did very poorly.
Why do you care? See, I was just gonna say, this has backfired a little bit, because Carl is genuinely, I don't know if he's actually upset or embarrassed, but it doesn't matter. Why does it matter? You were 15 and didn't go to school.
If you were my friends, I think you would have just said, oh, we can't find them.
Why?
Because
but you doesn't matter,
to
though.
What to do with that?
Well, what do you mean? What do you mean? It's ridiculous. Do it again because you want to learn because there's great things in the world to learn about. Don't worry. The GCSE is vocation. It's vocationally for a 15, 16-year-old to go on to do A levels or whatever or to get results. But you don't need that because you've done very well. You don't care about the Tudors and the Stuarts. I mean,
I've had a couple of jobs, not this one because you don't need qualifications to get a job.
Obviously,
yeah. In the radio.
Yeah. Obviously,
yeah.
A job.
Absolutely right.
But
yeah.
Ones that I have got. In the past, I did because I didn't collect them. I had to lie, and I didn't like go mad. I didn't say I had A's and stuff. But I think, I mean, I didn't put history down because I didn't even know I did it.
Like, so it's a bonus.
I kind of treated myself to like a D and a couple of C's and that. So it's like, well, he's not.
I love the fact that Carl even then was honourable. It's like I'll at least put down the ones I think I took and lie, but the ones I didn't take,
yeah.
I won't lie about.
Yeah, it. and don't give yourself a B.
Exactly.
If they're going to find out you lied, give yourself a B
next time,
Carl.
It could backfire, couldn't it? I mean, my brother's a bit mental, and he used to do things like go for jobs and say, "Oh yeah, I've done this before," like being a mechanic, and he's never even picked up a spanner, and yet he'd have the confidence to go and try and fix cars. Well, I'm not that daft, but God, an E.
Who do you blame for this?
That's just an easy way out. I have to blame myself. Don't
yeah.
I?
What was the teacher like?
Well, there's loads of different ones. I didn't like... I mean, the history teacher, she... It is my own fault, because with her, she's a bit mental. And I used to kind of stop the lesson by saying, oh, miss, tell us about your fireplace you've got that is made from a gravestone. Because that's what
that would
had.
Stop any English teacher in their tracks.
And she loved telling you about it.
Yeah.
It was like, oh,
I
weird.
Learned that from a teacher.
So that's why I didn't know about divorce, head loss, and all that.
Yeah.
Dandruff legs. Because horse, head loss, dandruff legs.
But remember now, divorce beheaded died, divorce beheaded survived. That's all you got to remember.
And what's that?
That's what happened to Henry VIII's various
in
wives.
Order.
In order.
What does it spell out?
No, it doesn't spell out
spell anything. You just got to remember
it.
The rhythm.
In order in which he married.
Yeah, but it helps. It's like when my mum taught me the alphabet. She taught me as like a song.
A, and like B, Constantin- C, D, E, F, G.
Yeah, Constantin- yeah. No, not like that. Huh. That's how everyone else could do it, and I couldn't do it that way.
Why?
What tune did she do it to?
It was A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y, Z.
Dandy Warhols, Get Off on XFM 104.9. I'm Ricky Gervais, with me Steve Merchant.
Hello.
It's 2:05 on the day that Carl, our producer, found out that he had an E in history, GCSE, and nothing else because he didn't actually register. I can't believe he registered for that. I don't know.
I didn't. That's
someone else put you in. They can't have put you in because you were away. They probably said, oh, you know, you didn't register in that. Listen. Obviously, you're feeling a little bit melancholy, because it's, you know, it's like you're hearing it for the first time, so it's like you're 16 again. But it was to be expected. But
no,
listen,
like
it doesn't matter. It actually
doesn't
matter.
It doesn't.
But listen, take it again. For your just is there a history teacher listening? What's the number? 08700 800 123. They can tell us the syllabus this year. 1234 is it?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. What is it?
08700.
And I did. I've got maths. 08700 800 1234. Mine's more laziness that I couldn't be willing to say that last digit.
Yeah. Yeah.
Really, I've done most of the work.
Yeah, if we get onto your problems, then we're going to be. It's a whole other show.
It doesn't matter really, because like you say, right? I've done all right for myself.
Yeah.
It's that old thing of like when you get older, if you find out that your dad's not your dad, it's like it doesn't matter. He was a dad to me.
Absolutely.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So...
Are you saying Mr. Nuttall wasn't your real teacher?
Give out the number again, Rick. What are we after?
08700 800 1234. Is
no
there a history teacher out there that may know how we can... Is he too late to register this time?
What's the syllabus this year?
What's the syllabus this year? Do we have to pay for it? And does he want to earn, like, 25 quid cash in hand to give Carl a couple of lessons? I'll stump that up. Take it, yeah? Be great. Be fantastic.
They probably won't want to do it, though.
We'll film it. It'll be a documentary on choice. Heat magazine be right behind it. There'll be, you know, little clues. We could have a little question and answer, little quizzes. You know what I mean?
Rick, before we play the next record, I've just been looking through the XFM gig guide, and I just wanted to let you know that at Spitz this evening, Commercial Street E1, doors at 8 o'clock, Gut Bucket are playing. So, no, just a lot of listeners will probably want to know that. So I don't want anyone to miss out on the Gut Bucket gig at Spitz tonight, Commercial Street E1.
Really, that's a good plug for the Gut Bucket boys.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage.
Now, Steve just played one of the most beautiful records. I mean, I've got up the ante here, and I'm gonna play another Jimmy Webb track. I played it off 10 Easy Pieces last week, and I have played this track before, but a different version. You all know it, obviously better by Glen Campbell. He wrote a lot of songs for Glen Campbell. And this is Galveston, and this is absolutely beautiful. Jimmy Webb there, and Galveston. See, and during that, Carl said, what's this about? Didn't ya? See, things you're interested in, you see? If only you're that inquisitive when the Tudors and Stuarts came up, you'd have a C or a B.
So we didn't even do Stuarts.
Didn't ya?
It's just Tudors.
Oh, they're the worst, aren't they? Stuarts, I've got a lot of time for. The Tudors can, you know what I mean? Listen, right. As you know, I lent Carl, part of his education, his historical education, I lent Carl Gladiator, the movie, on DVD, which he watched on his PlayStation 2, and Rasputin.
Do you know last week when you gave me this, did you know my result for history?
No.
That's weird, isn't it?
Yep. Now, right, okay, it's the film review. Carl, you just tell it from the heart. Tell us what you thought about the film, what you thought the...
Can I just ask, is this the first time you'd seen Gladiator? You'd never seen it before?
No.
Okay. And what were your thoughts?
Okay. The film review.
Gladiator.
It's alright. Nothing great. It's like an old, sort of an old version of Rocky done in the olden days, really.
Right.
A bloke fighting other people.
Sure.
How sort of well known is the story? Do you reckon people know the basics?
Well, just quickly do the plot.
Quickly. There's a guy called Max.
Maximus, yeah.
Yeah. There's Caesar, and there's Caesar's kid, and Max goes to war, sort of wins it, comes back. Caesar says, you're good at what you do. I wish my son was as good as you. So I want you to be in charge when I die. His kid finds out, bit annoyed about it, kills his dad, because he don't want anyone to hear that he said that he wants him to be in charge.
Yeah.
So his kid gets in charge and thinks, I'll show you. You're not going to be a king. I am. You're going to be a slave or something. And then next thing you see is...
Can I just stop there? My only thought is the film's 3 hours long, so maybe we should go through the whole plot.
We've done the first 10 minutes, but yeah. Go on. So yeah, he's a slave and then...
Yeah, but then, that was an interesting bit that I thought, right? I mean, I was watching this with a girlfriend. She was already annoyed because she wanted to watch Friends on E4.
Okay.
So...
Yeah. It was a good episode as well this week.
Was it?
Yeah.
Don't tell her that.
Okay.
Right, so so she was annoyed and she said, come on then, put it on. And I got it wrong straight away because it says on the back 149, so I thought that was an hour and 49 minutes. It turned out it was 149. No, I thought it was 1 hour 49.
Yeah.
But it was 149 minutes.
Sure.
So it overran anyway.
By 40 minutes.
Yeah. So anyway, the interesting bit was where he was going across the desert on a horse. And I think to show you how long he'd been going across the desert on his horse, he's showing you a shot of the horse's knees and they were bleeding. And I just wondered whether that's what horses do if they run for a long time. Can, do you know?
I don't. Good.
Right, so anyway, so it goes on, it keeps going on like this. He's a slave and then he has a fight at the end with the Caesar's kid and he kills him. And that's how it ended.
Okay, good. What did you think of it? Just generally, what bits... What do you think was wrong with it?
Right, well, I've read up on it, and there's already a fact that is wrong.
Right.
Max... No. Caesar's kid. He didn't actually kill his dad. His dad died of a natural death.
Right, in real life, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay.
And, what's Caesar's kid's name? Comedian or something? Comedian.
I think it's comedian. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's where the name comes from. When you, a funny person is called a comedian.
He didn't actually get killed in real life by Max.
No.
He died by his sister poisoning him, and he didn't.
Are you saying that this is not a historical document?
It's wrong.
All over the place.
Yeah.
Well, next week I'm giving you Braveheart, and that is actually true. That is factually accurate.
No, I can't handle
it. It is. It was a little Australian fella that helped him out.
Just for people who watched it, the guy, Caesar's kid.
Yeah.
He died. His sister tried to poison him. That didn't work. Apparently, he was a gay fella, and his boyfriend, who was a wrestler, strangled him.
Where did you get this information?
On the internet. I thought I'd look it up to see how much of it I actually got right.
Yes.
And that's what I read.
Okay, so out of 10?
5.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's no good. I wouldn't get it out. And it's annoying the way it says, like, you know, this film's got to be seen at the cinema, because I saw it at home, and I don't think I missed out on anything.
Very good point. I think that's probably the point they're making, but yours is valid too. We'll play a record, and after that, I'm going to ask you about Rasputin, the Mad Monk. Travis and Sing. I like that. It's all right. It's a bit easy. It's not their best. I like their earlier stuff a little bit better, you know. But what I don't like is them throwing around mollusks. I don't like it when that poor little octopus gets flung around. I know it's dead, but there's a certain lack of respect for the
For the mollusk.
For the
community.
For the squid and octopi fraternity.
Like I said to you, when I used to go to Wales for my holidays, they used to get washed up on the beach and people used to go over them on the motorbikes. And they were cheering and stuff, and it's just like, do you realise what you're doing?
Yeah, yeah. Sick, isn't it?
But anyway, Gladiator, just was going to add on the end of that. If you're into that sort of film, Jason and the Argonauts is probably your better bet.
Is that factually accurate?
Did you look that up or not? Did skeletons actually come out of the ground and fight you?
I don't know, but it's a more enjoyable film.
Okay.
And
okay.
It's shorter.
Okay, now, just moving quickly on, just the last item on Carl's re-education this week. Rasputin, you read a little book about Rasputin.
What did you know about Rasputin before you read the book, Carl?
Could I just tell you? Oh. When I handed him this book, it was my house, I said, right, he went, oh, is he the one that lived under the bridge? And I went, what do you mean? He went, the fella that lived under the bridge, and you had to pass him and Jane went, you're thinking of Rapunzel. And he went, yeah. And I went, well, that's not Rapunzel either. Rapunzel's, you had to say, isn't that, you know, you had to guess his
name. The person
name
who lived on the bridge was a troll in the Three Little Green Book Rough.
I'm a troll, foldy well. So, to answer your question, Steve, that's what he knew about Rasputin. Okay?
So have you read this whole book? Can I just have a look at it, Rick?
This whole book, it's about the size of a beer mat.
Yeah, yeah. And I'm just thinking, but did you read the whole thing?
No.
You didn't manage
to read the
whole
thing? Well,
you didn't even do that? Well, again, some of the names in there are so long and foreign sounding that I just thought, I can't remember all these. So no. I just got to the meat of the story.
Go on,
okay, what did
then?
You learn about Rasputin?
Right, he was a monk.
Yep.
And,
mad?
He...
Was he a mad monk?
Hang on a minute.
Don't confuse him.
Sorry.
Right.
Go on.
God. You see, this is what happened in the exams. Right, it was.
Oh, don't do that when I'm drinking, Carl. Please, mate.
He loved his women. And that's how the story started off. He had really nice.
The story started off. Yeah.
He had really nice eyes, and that's what everyone fell for, especially the women.
Yeah.
Anyway, the people back then thought he had special powers because he could hypnotise people or something.
Oh yeah.
And it was about a little lad who had some sort of blood clot on his leg, and he said, just calm down. And you'll be all right. And people thought he had special powers, but what he was doing, he was saying calm down and he relaxed and it stopped the blood flowing sort of as fast.
Mm.
And that's how he got better. But anyway, that's the only bit of special work that he did. And then he kept going on and he was going in brothels and all that. And the people in the town thought this isn't right. He shouldn't be going about doing this. And
where did he live?
Russia.
Right.
Is that right?
Yep.
What sort of era?
I thought you'd might now.
About 1800.
Okay. All right. Okay.
And then.
Do you want to check that, Steve? You got the book?
People
well,
got
I know
sick
for
of
a fact
him.
That's not right.
People got sick of him, and they said, "Oh, we'll have to get rid of him." So they tried to. He loved cakes as well as women.
Okay.
So they said, "Let's poison a cake," and they poisoned a load of
cakes. Easier than poisoning a woman, wouldn't
it? And he ate these cakes, and it just didn't kill him. And they were like, "God, what's going on?" And they kept giving him more and more cakes, and...
He was suspicious.
And that didn't work, so the fella said, that's it, I'm going to shoot him. So...
Well, I imagine it was the end of his tether.
So...
I mean, he was back and forth to Mr. Kipling's, you know, like,
he shot him once, and that didn't work, and the fella thought, oh my God. And he started running away, and Rasputin's running after him, and he shoots him, like, another... I think he took four
face
bullets.
Full of Battenberg.
Four bullets.
Did you swear then?
Four bullets. It took to kill him, and then this fella who was after him chucked him in an icy lake, and that was the end of him. But I don't understand, sort of.
What don't you understand, Carl?
Well, the fact that, you know, he's a bit of a name in history, and I don't understand why, because it just sounds a bit like my brother.
Does he love women and cakes, and do you think that'll be his downfall?
Right, I want you to study. Right, if you want to do that's the first introduction. Right, if you want to do some extracurricular
what would that
stuff,
get
there's a song by Boney M that
lays
it out.
Suzanne told me about that, saying about Russia's greatest love machine.
Yeah,
but it didn't say anything about cakes.
No,
so I think if you get the 12-inch mix,
no,
they
but they say according to Boney M, and I don't know who's correct, the bloke wrote that or M, they put some poison into his wine. Now I don't know if M. have done their research, or whether, they did shoot him until he was dead. According to them, he was the greatest love machine in Russia. I don't think it says that in the book, but M might know more than that fella.
So what's your final verdict on Rasputin?
Just a normal bloke who didn't have that much luck, really. That's what I don't understand. I was waiting for something special at the end, but just a normal fellow, really.
Yeah, just an everyday, happens all the time, doesn't it?
Just an everyday mad monk.
Yeah, just an everyday mad monk. You have to shoot and poison and throw in icy lakes to kill him, and who loves women and cakes. I mean, come on, do we need another one of them?
Boring.
So what would you say about him, then? How would you sum him up?
I think you've done it.
I think you've done it.
There you go.
So next week, Che Guevara, you going to read the book?
I don't know.
Come on.
Next week, Che Guevara. Take it home. There he is.
Give it here, then. Yeah. Nice one.
Good luck.
Cheers.
Alright, which Lex? The Sugar Babes are Freaks Electric. Are they, Carl?
Dunno. I feel like, feels like Christmas Day.
What, and you didn't get the gift you wanted?
Yeah, do you know that, like, anti-climax?
Yeah. When, you've been looking forward to it for so long.
Yeah, you know.
Well, I mean, I knew you were looking forward to it, that's why it took you 14 years to get the result, and then it was two other people that got them for you.
Do you wish that we hadn't done it?
Nah. It's alright.
It's alright, isn't it?
What's your girlfriend gonna say?
I don't think I'll see her again.
She likes a man who knows about the Tudors and Stuarts, does she?
Yeah, first Gladiator, then the...
Yeah, you've been bluffing. Whenever she said, what do you think of the Stuarts? You go, good. Like, yeah. Lots of things, but look, it's a bird.
What happened to Henry VIII's last wife? Oh.
Oh, I wouldn't... Yeah. Oh, look, Friends is on telly.
Friends is on.
Can I just change the subject by saying things like, you know, about the only king in a pack of cards?
That threw off the scent.
That threw us off the scent.
That wouldn't fool an invigilator, would it? Mm. That's the thing. You can't use that one with an exam board.
Carl, have you ever logged on to Friends Reunited? It was the site that everyone was talking about last year.
No.
Are you aware of the concept?
I've heard about it, but there's no one from school who I'd want to hook up again, really.
So basically, for those that don't know, you have to log on to his website, and then you can help. It helps you track down your old schoolmates if they've also logged on and stuff. And we took the liberty, really, of looking on the Friends Reunited site and typing in your school and trying to track down any of your old mates. We didn't get in touch with any of them, don't worry.
We didn't do that.
We're not going to surprise you with them now.
No.
But I was just interested to know, like, some of your thoughts on some of the names that I could run past you. I mean, these are people from your year. Just tell me if you recognise the names. Alison Birch?
Think I remember.
What's your thoughts on her?
Don't
be libelous.
Don't be like, no.
No. Posh. Probably did pretty well in history and that.
Sarah Morris?
God, yeah. Remember her.
Go on. You're grinning. What's the thought? Go on.
No, just, she was alright. She was a popular one.
What does that mean?
She was nice.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, what about, Darren Buckley?
He was one of my best mates.
Was he really?
Yeah.
Seriously?
Yeah.
What do you reckon he's doing now? Do you still keep in touch?
When my mum and dad were still in Manchester and they had a butty shop, he used to go in because the Buckies was next door.
I love the way you paint a picture! If you did this in your history exam, Carl, you would walk it.
Go on, so your parents had a butty shop, there was a Buckies next door?
Yeah, and he liked having a bit of a gamble, so he used to, I think he works for some insurance company.
Do you think that his fiancée Beth knows he's got a gambling problem? Yeah, or that his two-year-old son Lewis?
No!
Yeah, they live in Cheadle Home.
Hume. He must be doing well.
He's still supporting the Blue Army and frequents the shrine on a fortnightly basis.
Funny thing with him is, right, when I used to stay over at his house, and his dad was a copper, and I remember his dad came down and said, right, I want to see you two. I was like, oh, God, what's happened? And got us round the table. He said, do you know much about drugs? So we were like, what's all this about? So he goes, you know, they're not good for anyone, you know, the stupid thing to get into. And we're like, yeah, we know. And he went, you know, do you? He said, yeah. He said, what's this then? And he'd found something in his bedroom. And it was a Skittle.
What, the sweet?
Do you know little sweets with the S on it?
And oh, really?
Drugs.
Yeah.
So he said, well, yeah, it's a Skittle. Yeah, I know what it is.
Oh, he was bluffing like that as a slang word.
Yeah, he thought because he was a copper, he probably had to be down with all the terms and that. So we said, oh, it's a skittle. And he said, yeah, I know what it is, but what's it doing in your bedroom?
Oh.
It was like, no, it's a toffee. So, no, Darren there.
Yeah, I know, it's a toffee, it's a squib, it's a, yeah.
Carl, more people from your past. Debbie Carr?
Yeah, she was another nice one.
what does that mean? Is that a euphemism?
No, she was one of them that you'd sort of go, she's nice, but she'd never be your girlfriend. Do you know what I mean? She was
not really.
Even though she was in the same year, she seemed a lot older.
Right.
And like, wasn't a teacher, was it?
There was three of them who all hung together, and they seemed to hang around like the older kids, the ones who looked like men. Do you know what I mean? The
yeah. What did you look like then?
Well, it's just that I had youthful sort of looks, sure. Whereas like the older ones had like beards and stuff.
It's the gang of boys in the fifth form with beards. Were they smoking pipes? Come over here, me filly. Oi, you, oi, Debbie Carr, come over here, you little beauty.
No, but she was like...
I love that. Hanging around with beards. There's the big boys. What, fishing? That's lovely beards. What do you
I just see a whole row of George Bernard Shaws.
Brilliant. How do you do in history, boy? Yeah. They got an E. You're an idiot.
Oh. They were like, you know, I'd be there sort of playing, punching people in the arm.
That's a great game.
Oh, I love that, punch people in the arm.
Is that part of the Olympics now?
it's, I think it was exhibition this year.
Right. But it's going to be a pro next year.
It's going to be the Winter Olympics because you've got to do it in just a cap sleeve shirt, sure. In winter. Yeah.
So you're also playing that?
But
she didn't appreciate that. She used to go, ow!
No, I always think whilst I was doing that, they were like the Charlie's Angels and they'd be sorting out a mission somewhere because they were really like, there was something about them that you thought, you know,
they were private detectives.
What if it worked for a man they never see?
Okay, here's a name I'm interested in because, let me just tell you the name first. Adam Clifton.
Hmm.
Oh. Go on, what are your thoughts on Clifton?
He was one of them kids. He was alright, but he had that thing when, if you didn't have enough milk. He had, like, wrinkly hands and. white bits in his nails.
Oh!
Because he didn't have enough milk.
Yeah.
So therefore, you didn't like him because you didn't get enough milk.
This is not to be confused with the two people with the big heads and the webbed feet, is it?
Webbed hands.
Well, this was interesting.
I know that they weren't related. They must have been somewhere along the evolutionary sort of trail, do you know what I mean? They must have come from the same sort of stock.
But no, you wouldn't have liked him. It's just one of them people. He was alright, but...
Before you say any more, On Friends United, you can leave a little message which explains what you've been doing and your life's like now. And most people leave maybe two paragraphs.
Yeah.
Adam, I've printed it off. He seems to have printed. I think there's about six pages here of stuff. He keeps updating it, and he just basically lists his memories about everyone. Okay, at the school and what he thinks of everyone. And he says, I often see Simon. Da 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 da. He's doing all right for himself. Self-employed illustrator. Mark Cooper. Karl Pilkington.
Right.
And your name comes up. Now, I don't know if you've told us this story. I think you may have done, but I can't remember the facts about it. It just says, Karl Pilkington, with his pet bird, was it a magpie? I can't remember. He brought it to school to show everyone, and it flew away.
Oh, God. Oh, no, they do that, don't they?
What was the story, Carl?
You give them seed, and they just leave. What do you mean?
Well, this sounds like Kez.
Well, that's it. I was a big fan of Kez. And, it was the time our dog had just died.
Yeah.
So I didn't have any pets, and the cats were always getting run over.
Yeah.
And so we didn't want any more pets.
Yeah.
But there was a magpie that used to fly about on the estate, and I managed to sort of tame it. And in the end,
with a chair and a whip. What do you mean you tamed it?
Well, just used to sort of hang around it and talk.
But how did you get hold of it? Did you catch it?
Well, eventually, yeah, it used to just come to me, and the annoying thing was, it got to a point when I wish I hadn't bothered, because it used to pop me bike tyres. It used to sit on like, if I was talking to my mates and I was on my grifter.
I love the way he just throws things in.
It's like an Alan Bennett play.
It landed on my tyre, and it used to peck at the tyre and pop it, and then it used to then never go away, so it was always, like, around the house, and my dad said, never bring it in. So it used to sit on the porch, and I used to go out, and it used to fly down and land on my head, and it really hurt. It used to, like, peck and stuff.
He thought it was a tyre.
So it wasn't so much tamed as a stalker.
Oh, God!
Yeah. So you took it to school, and it flew away?
Yeah.
So did you take it in proudly, going, look at my magpie, oh...
Yeah. Oh, but no.
I think it got a bit confused in the area that it was in, because I used to just keep it sort of around our estate, but
sure.
The school was a bit of a distance away.
How did you get it there?
Carrying it on my finger.
Did you walk?
Yeah.
Wow.
So it was happy there, and then it got...
But it used to be one of those things that people would stop me in the street and sort of go, oh, what's that? Called it Maggie.
You didn't get Charlie's Angels to go and find out what happened to it? Investigate?
Were they impressed?
No, not really.
No.
But listen, go on, any...
Like Carl, let's come back to it. Let's have a hip-hop hooray track. It's the big hip-hop selection from Big Steve Merchant. I don't know what I'm talking about there. Just trying to sound hip. This is Spearhead from many years back. A track, again, I think got largely overlooked at the time, but worth hearing again. People in the Middle. Right. Spearhead, People in the Middle. Michael Franti, surely one of the greatest rappers, I think. If you've ever heard him bust it live, Rick, he's almost as good as me.
I'm just going to tell the listeners there, Carl, this is quite a little insecure sort of chap, and he was just worried about that last bit. He was going, who would ever find that interesting? He was worried about people finding him boring. And Steve said, as I said, you know, it's like an Alan Bennett thing. He went, yeah, but... You know, no one would care about Alan Bennett if he wasn't such a hit maker. They wouldn't care what he had to say. And we just looked at him for a while and he went, ah, oh, thinking of Tony Bennett. Bless him.
Listen, it's almost the end of the show, Carl.
Oh, yeah.
And it's really been a Carl special.
This is a Carl special.
Well, next week, we'll lay off next week.
He wants to retire a little bit. Just
Well, those old lottery numbers might come up tonight anyway.
Exactly. You might. What are they again? What's the four you've come up with?
Fuck my way now.
What? Come on, well, give us all six.
No.
Why?
Carl, while you're rummaging for that...
5, 9, 12 and 26.
A few more names that you may recall from Friends Reunited.
Go on.
Lisa Shuffle Botham? Do you remember her?
Yeah, she...
Was she one of Charlie's Angels?
No, she wasn't that nice, but she wanted me. her and her mate Rachel, I remember, I don't know why, but it was some sort of PE lesson where it had to be a bloke and two girls. And they were fighting over me.
Could you hear what they were saying?
They were just like, I want him. And I was loving it. Stuck in the middle and they were fighting over me. And then the next week I thought, I'll sit near them.
What sort of game do they play at this school?
I don't know.
That's an incredible game.
But I think
punch me on the arm, Carl.
They just went through it. Because the following week I thought, right, I'll sit near them again because I quite enjoyed the way they fighted over me. But then they picked somebody else and... I don't know who I was with that week.
So you didn't get any action with Shuffle Botham or a friend?
No. And then as she got older, she went a bit off. She didn't look that good. She's probably nice now. It's just, I mean, I'll say about myself, when you get to sort of the end of secondary school, you do sort of go a bit odd looking.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? When your sort of head grows funny.
I would just love to go back to his school of that era. I mean... Just what happened to people, whether, you know, all people sprouting limbs and things.
No, do you know what I mean? When you're like 12 and that, you're quite... No, not 12. When you're 10, when you're 7 to 10, you sort of look healthy and you look at your pictures when you go, yeah, I was a good-looking lad. But then when you get to late secondary school, something happens.
Yeah.
And you just look a bit odd.
Okay, well, what about Alison Thorpe?
Not sure about her. I sort of know the name, can't put a face to it.
Damien Comer?
Again. Know the name.
Yeah.
Can't remember anything.
No.
Yeah.
It's a shame. Well, those are pretty much all the names I could find. We've had some interesting thoughts, though, and interesting anecdotes.
Yeah.
Anyone in particular that you'd like to say hello to that maybe listening now that
no,
you...
No, I think I would have mentioned Darren Buckley if you hadn't brought him up.
Oh, right.
He was like me buddy.
Yeah. Did you ever see the Magpie game when you took it to the school and confused it?
No.
You're joking. That was the end of it, was it?
Yeah.
So where did it go?
Probably, to some other kid. Because, I mean, actually, it probably got killed. Because if it was being that friendly with other people, some people might have took advantage of it.
In what way?
Well, there was a programme on the other week about...
What, in the way that Shuffle Botham was trying to take advantage of you?
Well, yeah.
There was a programme on the other week about bear whisperers.
Yeah.
And some blokes got really friendly with a bear. And then when they were leaving that area where the bear was, they said, oh, we've caused a problem here because there's some bear hunters coming in and moving into this area. And it's going to get a bullet if it acts like this. So they had to scare it away, and that's what I should have done with Maggie. I should have terrified it a little bit so it wouldn't trust humans.
No. Just introduced it to some of your schoolmates, I'm sure, would have yeah. freaked it right out.
Well, the ones with
maybe
the
that was
heads.
Why it fled.
It didn't see those two fellas with big heads and webbed hands coming towards it, did it?
That would have terrified anything. It's like a scarecrow, like two walking scarecrows. Listen, have we got time for a song for the ladies? What's happening? Oh. We've not really thought.
Quick then, quick, just do
here.
It, just do it. Thanks very much.
Well, hang on, no, we haven't lined anything up, have we?
I was going to play Mary Lawson and that for you. And then
is this going to be the final track?
It has to
yeah,
be.
It would be, yeah.
We've blown it. We've blown it on the Karl special.
We have indeed.
I'll play it next week. So Karl there's got an E at history in GCSE. Yeah. Any history teachers, anyone who can help Karl out, I think we should try and register him and take it this June. So
what's your homework for this week?
You've got to read about Che Guevara, haven't you? Yeah. The revolutionary leader.
Yeah. Okay.
Do you know anything about him at all? Have you got any basis?
I just know that if you want to use his face on your business, it costs a lot of money. Do you know, like, if McDonald's wanted to have him as, like, instead of Ronald McDonald?
How does he do it? Steve, how does he do it, mate?
Oh, listen, just play a final record, Karl. Say goodbye, and we'll see you next week.
All right.
See you later.
Cheers, mate.
Oh, regret
is terrible. Pete Yawn, for Nancy, on XFM 104.9. I'm Ricky Gervais, with me, Steve Merchant.
Hello. Karl
Pilkington. Steve, you got any other toilet-related anecdotes?
Rick, my life is just full of toilet trauma.
Yeah.
And Karl, you may not realise this, but a while back I used to host, this is bizarre, I used to host a radio show on the BBC World Service, right? Now, if you want someone who's the voice of integrity, the voice of intelligence, the voice of a nation, you're going to come to me. That's yeah. obvious. And I was broadcasting to, now they've got listeners of something like 50, 60 million people around the world. It's mental, the listenership of the World Service. And I used to host this show with someone
It's a big place, Steve.
The world?
Yeah.
You're absolutely right. And anyway, so I had to be into Bush House, where they broadcast from, 10 o'clock every Friday morning to broadcast around the world to 50 million people, right? And one week, I went to the toilet in my house, right? Everyone had left. I got there a bit late. I got up a bit late. Already against me. The clock was already against me. Had to be there at 10 o'clock, broadcast around the world. And we got two toilets in our house, downstairs one, right? And the door had already been a bit dodgy. It was one of those doors where you had to give it a bit of a kick as you went in. It was getting a bit tight. I don't know what, the wood was expanding or something. You know, I'm in there. And same thing again happens, no toilet paper. I think, oh, God, I'm going to have to somehow kind of make it upstairs.
Why don't you check first?
I normally do, Rick. I normally do. It's just on certain occasions when I'm bleary-eyed or something, I forget, or occasionally I forget. Normally I do check.
Right.
And you've got to bear in mind that it's not like this is happening every week. This is over the course of many years that sure. these incidents have accumulated. So
you've condensed them?
For the purposes of this anecdote.
Sure.
Yeah. Yes. And, great, you're just brilliant to keeping the pace up of an anecdote there, Rick. You've just drawn in. I don't know where I am now. I know where I am. I'm trapped in a toilet with no toilet paper.
Yeah.
That's where I am. And I'm thinking maybe I peel off some of the wallpaper, you know, things like that. But there's nothing I can do. I got to go upstairs. Well, exactly. But I got to go upstairs and find
toilet paper. Was there any?
There wasn't.
Right.
I'll have to go upstairs and maybe find a notepad or something like that. Oh. And so I try the door. Right, the door's wedged. I'm pulling on the door and I can't. Get the door open. It's just like it won't come open, and it's already. And I knew it was going to come to this at some point. Like this is like the clock's ticking. I'm trying to pull the door open. Tries around my ankles again, and I'm thinking, well, what I could do is I could open the window, I suppose, and like try and climb out, but not really because I got the trousers around the ankles. And that's
or if it was raining, just stick your ass out. Two birds with one
stone.
Sadly,
it was a beautiful day, Rick.
I call it the World Bee Day.
Mm-hmm. And so, so what I'm thinking is, well, wonder. I got my mobile phone in there, luckily, because it's in my pocket. I'm thinking, well, maybe I could phone. I was seriously
Kleenex.
Thinking, maybe I'll phone the fire brigade.
By this point, I mean, it just dried.
No, it hadn't. It was.
Hold
it was,
on. Was that little puppy not around? Because sometimes you can call that. It's got a little bit wrapped around it.
Listen.
Or just use the puppy itself.
There's 50 million people around the world going to need to hear my voice in, like, 30 minutes.
Exactly. And where's Steve? He's not locked in a toilet again, is he?
Exactly.
Oh, no.
So I'm thinking about phoning the fire brigade, and I'm thinking, like, if I do that, it's going to be the first call that goes straight on the speakerphone for, like, the entire fire brigade service everywhere.
With a butch hero carrying you down over his shoulders with your trousers around your ankles. Exactly. Can I just not pull it up? No, you've got to be learned a total lesson.
Yeah. But I imagine the idea of a friend up and going, hello there, I'm trapped in a room in my house. Oh, yeah, which one is it? Oh,
it's
I don't need
small.
To know.
It's quite small. Is it?
Yeah. It's not the toilet, is it? Because we don't want to come and rescue someone who's trapped in the toilet.
Which service do you require? Paper.
So I think I can't find the fire brigade, the clock's ticking. So then I think one of my housemates is still in the house, but still asleep. So I phone the house number, right, phone rings and rings and rings for ages. And eventually, he answers the phone, right? Gets out of bed, answers the phone, yeah. Hi, it's Steve. All right, what's wrong?
What are you doing? Yeah. All right, yeah. Oh, I didn't wake you. No, no. What are you doing? Oh, just
in the toilet. I'm just downstairs in the toilet.
Oh, yeah, what are you doing? Oh, well, I've finished what I'm. Have you got any toilet paper?
Any bog roll?
Yeah.
So he had to kind of scrape together a few bits of paper, you know, and sort of tinfoil or whatever he could find in the house.
A cactus. Oh no.
Pass it underneath the door, right? And then I said, "Can you move away from the door while I? Because I don't want you to hear me as I'm, you know, wiping the."
And so he didn't say that.
Yeah, well, I didn't want him to, you know, that's embarrassing.
What were you wiping it with? Not tumbleweed. What do you mean? What noise?
I know what you mean.
Yeah. No, exactly.
Right.
So then I say, right, can you smash
Why was he hovering? Why didn't he want to walk away? Will you keep your what was it outside with a glass to his ear?
Yeah, yeah. Thankfully there was a window in the door, but it was frosted glass. Right. You could just see my semi-naked body moving around. And so eventually I said to him, look, listen, I'm going to need you to sort of kick the door in. He said, well, I don't want to kick the door in because you're going to have to pay for it, aren't we? I go, yeah, but I've got to go to the World Service. And he was a lovely man. He's the weakest man you've ever come across. It's like if there's one person you don't want to have to throw their body weight against the door, it was him. It's like he'll snap before the door will. So he's smashing against
the door. This sounds like a fetish to me, though. He went in there and there you were naked with lots of toilet paper. And you go, oh, you've broken the door down and there I am naked. Again.
Oh, you've rumbled me, Rick. I wish I'd not told that embarrassing story on the radio. Like it wasn't embarrassing enough, you've just got to make it slightly more seedy.
Oh, so did he get it down?
He did it, yeah, and I got to the World Service with, like, minutes to spare.
Oh.
And interestingly, I told that story to 50 million people around the world.
You're joking.
Yeah. Did they understand?
I think so.
I mean, is that a bit of a problem when you're on the World Service, like, thinking of things that everyone can understand?
Yes.
You can't
it's a bit like when talking to you, Carl.
Yeah, exactly, Carl. I think you're on thin ice there, worrying about people understanding what you're saying.
No, but you can't talk about stuff that's on the telly and that, because some people say, well, we haven't even got a telly here.
Oh, yeah, you're listening to XFM 104.9. Play a record. Nirvana, All Apologies on XFM 104.9. I'm Ricky Gervais, obviously, with me, Steve Merchant, Karl Pilkington. Well, Steve, I met up with... I know it's forbidden, usually.
Let me just explain
to the listener. Me and Steve have got a little bit of a pact. We're not allowed to talk to Karl during the week because he comes out with too much dynamite and we want it to be fresh and it's just unfair. And if he sees us laughing, he clams up a little bit because he knows something's wrong with his head. So, I was in a pub, and Karl called, he returned a call, I'd called you earlier, and I said, oh, I'm just across the road, come over. And he came over, and we had a conversation, and I kept saying, no, save it, and I can't remember half the things he was saying, but I do remember one thing he said. He said that the human eye never grows. He said, unlike your ears and nose that keeps growing all your life, he says the human eye never grows. Now, there's a little bit of... He says, now you look at a baby, it's got big eyes. It's got the same size eyes as it will have.
When a baby's born, everyone always goes, oh, look at its eyes, don't they? Because that's like the main feature. Yes. They're quite big. They don't grow, they don't get any smaller, they stay the same size.
What, you mean once you become an adult, you've the same sized eyes?
No. Soon as you come out of the womb, your eyes, the size they are as a little baby... They stay the same size.
Until you die.
The sockets.
And I said, I pointed out to him, right, you know, I said, if that was true, Steve Merchant, when he was a baby, with these eyes he's got now, would have looked like a hammerhead shark.
All right, calm down. You don't want to go lay into the eyes.
Do you know what I mean? Just to prove my point.
I didn't laugh.
Good.
When he said that.
Respect.
Do you know what I mean, though?
I've got the eyes of the windows of the soul. And mine happen to be enormous plate-glass windows. Yeah. But, you know, nevertheless, they're beautiful.
Many
people find them beautiful.
Yeah, they're great. Yeah, many people do.
Do you know they don't have kneecaps either?
My eyes or?
What?
Babies. when they're born, they don't get kneecaps until they're about two.
They don't get kneecaps?
Is that true?
Yeah.
And also, what are you talking about? Isn't it a bone? It's part of the
Well, no, but you've got lots more bones when you're born. Than
yeah, you've got 300 when you're born, then 205 when you're an adult.
Yeah, they all fuse, don't they?
Do they?
The head's got to be all soft to come out.
Right.
As we said earlier, you know.
I would know, I'm a shark.
Oh,
so
God.
What did you say when he said about my eyes being huge?
Okay, get off it.
That isn't nice, considering he's not here. Yeah, should I wait until he's here when I slag him off?
Yeah. Farewell. No, nice one, Carl. You're an honourable man.
Oh, well, there's... I know, you see, the thing is, right, that made me think that it might be a little bit of truth in this.
There is well, that... the ear thing. Have you seen that with old
that's
men
true,
who
yeah.
have really long ears?
Yeah.
And big noses.
Yeah. Do they eat buns and walk around in the jungle, these old men?
You mean that the ears and the nose carry on growing?
Yeah, they do, that's true. That's true, it's cartilage.
Yeah, but not like, it's not like sort of Pinocchio.
No, after you're dead, you leave a body lying around, he's got a huge elephant
really?
Type ears.
Really? If you left him long enough?
4 foot nose, that's what, yeah.
That's
no, but see, it's about the focal length in your eye, you see, because it's like a big lens. So it makes sense that they couldn't change that much. Because an owl, do you know why an owl turns its head round? Sort of like 180 degrees.
No.
Because it can't move its eyes, because the eyes take up the whole... It's the biggest eye in the animal kingdom. The eyes take up the whole of its skull.
Really? That,
yeah, and it has to move its... Yeah.
Has it got a brain in there as well?
It's got a brain in there, yeah, above the eye. Yeah. When I say the whole of the skull...
Quite, yeah. There's also some space for the brain.
What I meant is the two diameters of the eye is the diameter of the...
You've lost
the
me there with diameters.
You didn't like maths, did you?
No, don't like maths. Never understood it. Couldn't get to grips with maths. I don't know about you, Carl.
Did you do maths, Carl?
Now, how did you do in your exams on the maths? Did you do that? I bet yours was rather like my theory, which is why do you need to figure it all out when you've got a calculator?
Exactly.
Yeah, I knew it.
Yeah.
You're right. And I agree.
Well, let's play a record, and afterwards I'm going to be testing you on your homework this week, Carl.
Could we do White Van Man first?
We could do... Oh, just to... You no, know, they've got to know what they're dealing with, yeah. Carl's homework was to read all about, as you know, Che Guevara.
Absolutely.
Last week he did well on Rasputin, didn't he?
Did very well on Rasputin. Yeah, perhaps with flying marks there.
Let's have a bit of Wu-Tang, shall we?
Then let's have White Van Carl. Yeah. White Van Carl. Nice.
Yeah. Don't erase none of that good shit. Yeah. Wu-Tang Clan, there, Steve. XFM 104.9, with Gervais, with Steve Merchant and Karl Pilkington. Now, I just, remind him of something else, Carl's in the week. I know it's forbidden to talk to him, but I'll tell you this. He was talking, he was very excited about the Friends Reunited. He was a bit nervous at first, wasn't he, last week? But he was really getting into it. In the pub he was talking about those people, he said, I'd never go on a reunion, though. He said, I'd never do that.
What, a school reunion?
Yeah, and he wouldn't want to see anyone. And I went, I said, wouldn't you want to see those two lads with the big heads and the webbed hands?
Oh yeah, these were people you went to school with, weren't they?
Yeah.
Well, I didn't knock about with them, they were in the class.
What were they called?
Freaks.
Right.
Right. Okay. And he said, no, I wouldn't want to see them. He said, because what could you say? Oh, you haven't changed much. Right? And he said, and they wouldn't go anyway, would they? I said, why? He went, well, they didn't have any friends.
Right.
And I said, well, weren't they friends with each other? And he went, no. That would have been too obvious. Like, they passed it and went, no, I know it's tempting, but let's not.
Everyone would think that's just what we were going to do.
Yeah.
Let's not do it.
Yeah. So they didn't even hang around with each other.
No.
See, I must say, in my head, I've got something like, it's like some sort of extra thing from Blake 7, that they're like some sort of, you know, lagoon monster. But they just had slightly oversized heads, did they?
See, does your head grow? Your eyes don't, does your head? Because maybe they've got to a point now that it's all sort of caught up with each other.
Well, at the time, the eyes were very small and the head was huge.
Just a very big head. And yeah. The fingers aren't going to change, you know, that's not...
They had not webbed fingers?
It was like the penguin in Batman.
Really? Are you sure?
No, honestly.
Are you sure they weren't wearing mittens?
No, seriously.
Yeah, it wasn't home economics. They weren't getting some out of the oven, a very hot dish, weren't they? Every time you saw them.
But why were there two, but they weren't related and they weren't friends?
I don't know, I suppose it's like asthma and that, isn't it? Some kids have it, and it just was a coincidence.
Yeah, but asthma's quite a common thing. Webbed hands, Carl.
Yeah. I don't know, you don't think of it, do you, when you're a kid? You just sort of... when you first see them.
Yeah.
There goes the frogmen. Anyway, Carl, look, let's have a little quick session of White Van Man. For those that don't listen to the show regularly, The Sun, as you may know, has a section called White Van Man where a member of the public gets asked their opinions on the week's big political and social hot potatoes. Carl, we just thought it would be fun if you answered some of the questions. It's not so much questions, it's just your views, really, on these big news stories. What do you make of Olympic ski hero Alan Baxter testing positive for drugs?
What did he do?
Well, he won a gold medal in the Olympics, and
for
he...
What?
He was a skier,
right?
And he won gold medal, and they've just tested him positive for some kind of illegal drug.
But what? I mean, if he did, why take drugs to ski?
Why?
Because all you do is balance.
But imagine, it'd be amazing if you were stoned, like, going down a hill.
Yeah, it's not like you have to...
It's not going to help you,
No, it's just
like...
gravity that's doing all the work, isn't it, with skiing?
Yeah, but it's often to do with your athleticism, isn't it?
No, but it'd be like saying, and we've just found out the people on the toboggan were on crack. It's not going to help them. You sit there and you go with the flow.
Yeah.
Could I say?
The drugs
apparently
he was taking.
That's his defense.
Probably he probably wasn't jacking up H or dropping a few E's or getting stoned. He was probably taking more sort of performance enhancing drugs as opposed to him just like scoring some shit around the corner from someone, getting off his tits and jumping in a toboggan. Doesn't mean that, yeah. Does it?
He wasn't off his nut.
Yeah, yeah. You've pissed out your head.
But why doesn't he just say, don't be stupid, why would I do that? It's just not going to help me out.
But it is, isn't it? Because performance enhancing drugs Wait a minute,
Carl. Right, look at this way. Okay, look at me. Yeah? Have I got his attention?
Yeah, the light's glinting off your ring there.
Yeah. Okay, right, now keep concentrating. Right. Some athletes, you're aware they take drugs, that's to build up
swimmers
muscle.
Swimmers and stuff.
Yeah, swimmers.
Runners,
yeah. Not only do they help build muscle, right, but they can actually, give them a boost performance-wise, yeah. Sort of like steroids and all this sort of stuff. Right? So that's the sort of thing we're talking about, okay?
Right, so again...
He wasn't on a bong
would that help
before...
You?
What?
Why would that help you when you... All you've got to do is balance on skis.
Not when you're at the Olympic level.
Yeah.
There's a lot to do with, your body and your legs.
No, it's practice, isn't it? It's like, if you've skied for years, then you've got good balance after a bit.
Oh, do you know what, Carl? Do you know what? You've made a mockery of drug taking. Well done. Right, yeah. Next one, Steve.
I hate this bit.
I don't know if you saw it. What did you make of Posh Spice's Warts and All documentary?
Yeah, I saw a bit of it.
What did you make of it?
I mean, people are slagging him off, aren't they, saying, she's daft and that, but...
Daft, mate, you!
She's... I think they're all right, honestly.
Yeah,
she's all right. I mean, I think David's really a decent bloke.
Sure. Would you agree that he's quite a simple man?
Yeah, but he's a footballer, he doesn't need to be, you know what I mean? It's like me.
Yeah.
Like, alright, I only got an E in history.
Sure.
But knowing about the Tudors doesn't help me press these buttons and put the next CD on.
No, sure.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, good luck to him, and he's done well out of it, and it's just jealousy.
Yeah.
I remember, though, when I was back in Manchester, was in Piccadilly train station, and he was there, right? Not as big a star as he is now, back then, but he was stood there, and I was so close to going over to him and saying... Did you go to my school? Because I recognised his face, but I didn't know who he was. Do you know when you sort of go, sure, I went to school, it's not the one with the big head.
Yeah.
But I do recognise him, then my girlfriend got off the train, and I said, I'm sure I know him. She said, yeah, it's David Beckham. And I was so close
to
going
over. Oh, thank God for your girlfriend. Does she get an awful lot of scrapes, does she?
She does, yeah.
Okay, what about the fact that the pension crisis is going to force Britons to work into their 70s, Carl? You might have to carry on working into your 70s before you can claim a pension.
I think it's a good thing. Because you see a lot of old people who look bored.
Okay.
And I honestly think if you keep your brain busy, you'll live longer.
Yeah.
It's only when you actually shut down, right, that's when your body sort of dies because it doesn't feel it has a purpose. Yeah. It's like if you've got flu, keep going to work. If you have a day off, you just feel worse, you'll mope about at home, doesn't do you any good.
What about, where do you draw the line there? What if you, say, lose a finger? Pop into work?
Depends. If you can't concentrate because it's painful.
But what if you're a typist?
You're not going to type as many words, but you'll do more at work than you would having a day off at home.
Sure. Okay. Tony Blair turning trendy with his Paul Smith-designed naked lady shirt. I don't know if you've seen this. It's the one with the pictures of naked ladies on the cuffs.
And...
Okay. And finally...
This is what annoys me about this feature. It's just, what's that? So what?
Yeah, but it's the Prime Minister of this country wearing a trendy shirt with naked ladies on the cuffs.
All right.
Okay. And finally, what do you make of the fact that Top of the Pops have banned Will Young singing both tracks on the number one slot, and consequently he wasn't on there at all, they had to show the video? The first time anyone's ever made this demand. He wants to sing both the A and B side.
Well, he can't.
It's double A, yeah.
Double A side.
That's what he wanted to
do. That is how it works, is it?
Yeah, I agree, yeah.
And the thing is, which one... I mean, at the end of the day, loads of people have bought it, haven't they? And it's like one of the best... So it doesn't really matter what it does, because people have got it. They can listen to what song they want at home. It doesn't matter about what Top of the Pops do.
Yes.
And it's just annoyed me now.
Who's annoyed you?
Just what goes on in the world. I'll tell you, you're better off not knowing. It's better being in my little world. If that's what people are talking about on the streets and asking the white van man, do you know what I mean?
I think you're right, Carl. I think you're right. Shall I play a lovely song for you? Because you're getting all stressed now, aren't you?
I've not had a good day.
No, I know. We tell you about it later. It's not a good day. Well, I'm going to play a Neil Young track here of Harvest. It's Alabama. It's beautiful, and this is for Carl. Athlete, West Side. I still like that one.
It's a good track.
Yeah, I was worried it's a bit novelty, it would go off very quickly. But it's good.
No, it's not bad at all.
On XFM 104.9, I'm Richard Bays with me, Steve Merchant, Karl Pilkington, Steve.
Well, we were talking about the news just now, and there was a story I heard in the week. I think it was on the radio, and I don't know all the details. But what I heard was that a number of, I think it was Falkland, maybe Gulf War veterans, were, I think, suing or complaining to the government because they wanted compensation for post-traumatic stress disorder. Now, I don't know all the ins and outs of it, but it seems to me that if you're in the army and you're a soldier, a certain degree of trauma is kind of inevitable. I mean, after all, if you're any good at your job, you are going to see people getting killed. So I don't understand what the ins and outs of it are. I don't know why.
No, right, when it came back and Tony Blair met him and go, all right, well, not really, no. Go on, what's the matter? Well, if you, there was people shooting at us and everything, it was all muddy. Well, calm down, don't cry. Well, I will.
There was a drill sergeant just kept shouting, saying, look at you, stupid boy, where's this gun's not clean? And I just cleaned the gun and it was fine, and now he's telling me to clean it again.
Yeah, the boots, they were shiny.
Well, he's
got to do that, it's more distant.
His neck was as big as his head.
Well, yeah, but you don't know what they, you know.
I don't know what the ins and outs of it are, but,
What you got to do is make sure you know what you're going into, that's what I do, you got to check the small print. So if I was, you know, going over to, like, the Falklands or, you know, the Gulf, I'd put my hand up and go, will it be horrible? I go, you at the back, yes? Will it be horrible? It will be horrible, yes. It will be horrible. There will be shooting and lots of death and everything. I go, right, I'm not going to go. And they go, exactly. Okay then. Okay.
That should be fine, yeah.
Should be fine, yeah. Just like that. Is anyone else scared about this? Pretty much all of us. Okay then, well, we won't send anyone then.
Exactly.
My brother went into the army, right, because he couldn't get a normal job. And my dad said, you know, if you don't get a job by such a date, that's it, son, you're going in the army. So when was the Falklands? Was it about
81?
Right? And he joined back in like 81 or something. And he, I don't know, he was in Aldershot or something.
Oh, yeah.
And he wrote back to me mum saying, you know, a bad time to join, bad time in this. So she wrote...
What bad time to join? That's so sweet, Carl, isn't it? That's like, dear dad, yeah, well done.
don't know if you've noticed.
Yeah. I was on the dole, that's for sure. Thank you for joining. A month before the Belgrano.
Anyway.
Go on.
My mum called up, spoke to the sergeant, and said, can you leave him out of this one?
Can you leave him out of this one? The Falkland War?
He's only just joined, and she called him Chuck, which he got done for. Like, she's one of them, I think it's a northern thing, like, saying, how are you, Chuck?
Yeah.
And she called the sergeant Chuck, and the sergeant said to, like, my brother, your mum, you know, she's called up and asked if you can not go, which, of course, you know, I mean, we'll see how it goes, but can
what?
You tell
what
her...
What? What do you mean? Why did the sergeant even entertain this?
Well,
Pilkington, come here. Your mum's been giving me a bit of earache. Now, listen, tell her I've told you, but can you call her, because she called me Chuck and everything, can you call her and say you don't mind? Well, not really. Oh, please, because I've promised her, say you want to go. No, please, say you want to go. Why was he entertaining this phone call?
Probably because he was new.
What?
Because he was new to the army, I suppose.
Who? No, I mean the sergeant.
I don't know, maybe they do that.
So what happened? Did he didn't go in the end?
So he didn't go, no.
You can't do it!
That's ludicrous!
I love it, though. Oh, we went over the top. Pilkington, no, I've got a note. Yeah. Is this really your mum? Yeah. Okay, no, this seems to be in order.
Because I notice it says, I do not want to go into the army, I don't want to go and fight, and it's crossed out and it's good, my mum says don't go.
Yeah.
Now, you didn't write this yourself.
No, my mum wrote this. Okay.
You definitely wrote this yourself.
You're going to have to fill envelopes.
No, I'm sure if he was needed, he would have had to go, but I think they made a bit of a special effort. They sort of said, oh.
Well, it wasn't conscription anyway. Oh, no, obviously.
But were the other soldiers going around just going,
wah? Pilkington.
No, he ended up being a mechanic in there, and he got kicked out for going for a packet of fags in a tank.
What?
Now, wait a minute. Do you mean he nipped down the shops in a tank.
Yeah.
I don't believe that, Carl. You've
honest to God. That, and he went off with the sergeant's wife. So that didn't help, and he ended up getting kicked out.
Sorry, your brother's a genius.
I love this. I love this. First of all, he gets a call from his mum, go and let him off. He goes, oh, God. Then he goes, where's Pilkington? His mum's on the phone. Where is he? He's near your house, Sarge. Near my house? Well, why is... No reason. Well, when he comes back, when he's finished, tell him his mum called. And can he get me a packet of fags? Tell him to walk this time.
Wow.
This is ludicrous.
So the sergeant phoned out that he was sleeping with his wife?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean,
did your mum phone out and say, let him off?
No, let him off this time. Can he... That's fantastic.
But he misses it. I mean, I haven't seen him for about 11 years. But ever since he came out, he's just kept getting into trouble and that. And the army, you know, people slag it off. But I think if you're a certain type of person, it's good for
it
you.
It didn't straight him either. How did it?
No.
He was going down the shops in a tank. He was shagging someone behind their back.
It's really weird. It's like back then, he was like a proper adult. And he had a house and he collected crystal with his wife and that. And now, he hasn't got any of that.
Has he got the wife?
No.
Has he got the crystal?
Don't think he has.
And he hasn't got the house.
Seriously, I haven't seen him for about 11 or 12 years.
Carl's stories always start off nice and funny, and then they just leave me empty and slightly depressed. I don't know whether to hug him or shoot him, put him out of his misery. Can we take Carl to the... phone in if you think I should take Carl to the vet and have him put down. Because it's just too stressful. Main offender, XFM 104.9. Wow, it's that time in the show where I test Carl on his
homework.
Yeah, for the week, history, the re-education of Karl Pilkington. As you know, we found out last week that he'd taken one GCSE and he'd got an E, and it was history.
Do you know, Steve? I haven't told you this. Went shopping on Sunday, buy some new jeans. Was in a shop. Saw an old lad who I haven't seen for about 2.5 years. Went, you all right, mate? How are you doing? First thing he said, sorry to hear about your exam results.
Oh, God. Had he listened to the show or someone had just told him?
Yeah, he was on a train listening to it on the way to a football match or something.
He knew that you were on the show, did he? He was a regular listener.
First thing he said, sorry about your exam results.
Haven't people have been coming up to you in the station going, you all right? Do you want to talk about it or?
God.
I know. Well, you did take it pretty badly. For a 29-year-old man.
Just a bit of a shock, because it annoyed me that...
It wasn't a shock. You knew you hadn't got any.
No, I thought I'd have got a bit more than that. I wasn't expecting, you know...
But you weren't. You didn't even think you took history, so that must have been a bonus.
Yeah, that's what my girlfriend said.
Yeah.
So, well, but didn't she say something quite philosophical, which was like, you know, you didn't even have an E this morning?
Yeah, she said yesterday, you know, you didn't have anything today.
Exactly.
Which was good.
Yeah.
Mm.
But anyway...
Anyway, okay then, well, you were tested on Che Guevara. Right, Carl.
We should just remind people what happened, because
this is a little series. I've got lots of these little books, right? They're about, like, 2.5 inches long by about, you know, 2 inches wide. Those tiny little things you see in the, sort of, on the front counter of Waterstones or Smiths, and it's the Life and Times, a series of all the greats in history. Last week you read about Rasputin, you wasn't impressed.
No.
This week...
This book's a little bit thicker than the Rasputin one.
No, it's the same, I think, was it? Maybe the writing's
figure writing or something.
But okay, Che Guevara. Who was Che Guevara? Now, you learned to pronounce it, right? And how do you remember? You told me in the week how you remembered what his name was.
Che is like shake, and his surname is like guitar.
Right.
Chevara.
Okay.
But anyway, right.
Tell us what you know, and we'll ask.
Right. First of all, his name. Isn't really Che.
Right.
It was something else, and Che means buddy in wherever he's from, Argentina.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That's right, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yep.
Right, so anyway, he was born, and he was,
By the way, Carl's not reading this from a book now. This is all out of his own head.
This is not pre-planned notes.
No, this is... I mean, I know it sounds written, but he's just riffing on this.
Right, here we go.
Go on.
He was born, He had bad asthma as a kid,
right?
Which I thought was quite interesting because they didn't have cars and that back then, and that's what they're blaming asthma on these days, the bad build-up of traffic and that.
Well, they did have cars, Carl.
Not as many as they have now.
Okay.
So that was something I picked up early in the story.
He had asthma. Yeah.
His dad was into he wasn't a politician or anything, but he was, you know, they were into the politics.
Sure.
So he sort of grew up around a family who was into, you know, watching the news and that and keeping up to date on what's going on in the world. So that sort of rubbed off on him. He went to school. He was doing stuff on medicine.
Yeah.
Yeah, he wanted to be a doctor, or he thought he did.
Yep.
Anyway, he learned really quick. He did, like, 6 months work in about 3 months. So he could have some time off school or something.
Right.
So he took that time off and went to travel South America with his mate.
Okay.
On a motorbike.
Yeah.
And he saw all this bad going on in the world. And he thought, oh, this is bad, this.
Yeah.
You know, I could do something here. I could change this, make it a nicer place to live. So he said, what I'm going to do is join a gang that sort of is against the, like the government.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. Am I right so far?
Yeah.
You're doing very well.
Right, and the woman who he met, who was, like, running this gang, is a woman called Hilda, who he later married.
Right.
And Hilda introduced him to Castro.
Right.
Who was, like, the head cheese of the gang.
Right.
Who wanted to change things.
Okay.
And, so, she said, like, this is, I think his real name was Engelbert or something like that.
Ernesto.
What?
Ernesto.
Ernesto. She said, this is Ernesto. He does medicine. Should have him in our sort of army. Yeah. So when there's injuries and that, he can make people better.
Yeah.
So he said, yeah, all right then. So he joined the gang and they went went to sort of, I'm chopping it down a bit.
You're condensing this.
It's not in real time.
No.
So, so anyway, so they go
It feels like it.
You see, this is why I just wanted to you to ask me questions.
Well, listen, let's cut to the chase then. So, obviously, he made his name as part of the Cuban Revolution.
Yeah.
Do you know what date that was?
About, no, I don't.
Okay. And, obviously, so, he was a big involvement in that.
Yeah.
In which country was he caught?
He was caught in Bolivia.
Yeah. How did he die?
They executed him.
Yeah.
He shot him, and his last words before he died, right, the guy's there with the gun, and he wasn't scared, he wasn't, like, crying or anything. He said to the bloke with the gun, he said, go on, shoot me, be a man, and they shot him.
And did it tell you what happened to him after that, his dead body?
No, but Suzanne was telling me about this the other night. She said there's more to it than that. They stuck it in a glass coffin, didn't
they?
Well, no, but before that, they cut off his hands and his feet
and sent them to the...
No, and that, because they buried them in different places, and then they buried the body. I think they might have sent the hands to Fidel, but they buried him in an unmarked grave because they didn't want anyone to start using his grave or his tomb as a place of martyrdom. But, of course, that just made him even more of a martyr because no one knew where he was buried, so it just meant that he was even more of a...
Yeah, but that wouldn't work anyway, because if they did find out, that's more places people can go and sort of grieve. Do you know what I mean? If you've got all these different graves...
What, with different parts of his body?
Well, you've got a foot over there, and it's like, well, you know, oh, God.
His head over there.
Thanks for what you're doing.
So, essentially, what's your summary of Che?
Yeah, you like him more than Rasputin, don't you? A
lot better bloke than Rasputin. I can understand why he gets one of those little books. Well worth knowing about, and good bloke. Did a lot, you know.
Crammed a lot into his short life.
Yeah. But, yeah, interesting bloke.
But just on the subject of Che Guevara, Steve called me up in the week because he was going through the duty log. We love the complaints on the BBC duty log. And someone had written in because one of the Blue Peter presenters was wearing a Che Guevara T-shirt. And what did the bloke say?
Yeah, this is a series of... People can phone in and write and complain to the BBC about different things.
Why would you complain about wearing something?
Well, this was the thing. Is you complain about... The best one... I mean, there's been some amazing complaints.
Oh, there's some great ones.
My favourite one that wasn't a complaint but was actually just someone had to phone in was, what an excellent edition of Kilroy this morning.
Lots of that. There's things like, Esther was superb. Woman called.
There was a brilliant one I remember once, which was... Robbie Williams was wearing a Nike T-shirt on Top of the Pops last night. Product placement on the BBC.
It's just all
so
things that are. Yeah.
But anyway, this was one phone call. There was a presenter on Blue Peter. She was wearing a T-shirt with Che Guevara's face on it.
Right.
And someone had written in and said, or someone had phoned in and said, very worried to see a presenter wearing Che Guevara's face on a T-shirt. Are you trying to turn my children into communist revolutionaries?
Yeah.
Imagine that. Imagine who's thinking that. Who's bothering to phone up with that information, Carl?
Yeah.
Who knows what they're going to say about this show? Yeah. I mean, you've been championing the work of Communist Revolution.
Luckily, no one listening to this show can either write or operate a phone. So I think we're pretty safe. So thumbs up for Che Guevara.
Yeah.
Well done to Carl there.
Yeah, no, I thought he was brilliant.
I did
alright,
didn't I?
But the thing is, you keep saying to us, you don't understand why history's interesting, and yet you're clearly interested by that. You remembered that
Carl,
information.
I've got a few in the series. Can I give you your next week's homework?
Go on.
There you go.
Oh.
Read it out.
Hitler.
The Life and Times of Hitler.
1889 to 1945.
Yeah.
Do you know much about him?
What was the significance of that last date? Why did he? What was the thing was that last date, Carl? Why do you think he died in 1945?
End of the war.
Yeah.
Which I'm interested in. So this.
Yeah.
This will have stuff about Anderson shelters and that.
It might not be covered in the Hitler biography, the Anderson shelter, but.
Check if there's a special Anderson chapter. Anderson shelter chapter.
Well, I'll look forward to this.
It'll be
interesting.
Powdered Egg is page 4.
Yeah.
Excellent. Well, we're going to play a hip-hop.
Yeah, it's time for a hip-hop hooray. People are absolutely in love with this feature, Rick, as you well know, and I know you're somewhat jealous of it.
Yeah.
This week, I know that Outkast are currently on the playlist, aren't they, with their new single, Whole of the World? Is that what, The Whole World? Anyway, this is a track from the big compilation, Outkast. It's just a sort of compilation of all their greatest hits. And this is a good one. It's called Rosa Parks. Play it, Carl. Their greatest hits album, that's Outkast, and a track called Rosa Parks.
Like it.
Yeah, enjoy it.
Yeah. Now, we just had a call from someone, impressed by Carl, and Carl's very pleased because this guy has actually done a PhD on Che Guevara. So, in theory, whatever subject he chose, in theory, he's probably one of the experts in the world on this particular field. Now, hello, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Hello, what's your name?
My name's David.
David, now where did you do your PhD?
Did it at UCL.
Did it at UCL, my old college. And what was the actual title of the PhD?
It was Che Guevara's influence on class struggle in Europe in the 60s.
And what did you think of Carl's performance?
I thought he did really, really well. The only thing, I'd never heard those last words before.
So Carl actually knows something you don't know?
Yeah, possibly.
Although you presumably not take that as verified information. You probably wouldn't take everything Carl said as gospel. You'd probably look it up yourself, would you?
I probably would have a look, yeah.
Did you know about baby's eyes?
Sorry?
Did you know that baby's eyes don't grow?
I didn't know that.
You see, that's why you shouldn't take things Carl says as gospel. Because it come out with something, you know, vaguely intelligent and then say, did you know about baby's eyes don't grow?
Any questions that you'd want to test Carl on? Any thoughts, any things he missed there on the history of Che Guevara?
I think he did really well and, I think he should be congratulated.
Because Carl has problems with understanding why people are interested in history. And even though he's been reading these books, he keeps saying, why does anyone care about history? Why is it important? What would you say to Carl?
I think he should maybe then look at who Che Guevara did influence and why he still influences people today.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, he knows that he influenced Citizen Smith, and he knows that if McDonald's ever wanted to swap Ronald McDonald for Che Guevara, it would cost him an awful lot of money. So he is trying to apply it to the modern world. He is having a go.
Well, maybe you should think, like, why Rage Against the Machine have him on their T-shirts?
Good point, Carl. What do you think of that? What do you think they have him on the T-shirts, Carl?
I don't know. Maybe that was a design of the T-shirt. Maybe they wanted another T-shirt.
Maybe they wanted Ronald McDonald.
But didn't have any in.
Sure.
And they said, oh, we'll have that one there, then.
Well, thanks very much, Dave. Just before you go, do you think Carl would be an interesting subject for a PhD?
Yeah, very much so, yeah.
Okay, well, if you're not
hopefully one day you'll become a professor and you can maybe set that as some coursework.
I could do, yeah.
Carl Pilkington. Imagine that.
Cheers, Dave.
Imagine having an MA in Carl Pilkington. Thanks very much, Dave.
Okay, bye.
Cheers, bye.
That's good. My teachers never did that.
What encouraged you in that way?
Never said well done. So
really?
Yeah.
But you never showed up.
Yeah, they have to be in the same room.
They were
really
too busy saying, who are you?
Yeah.
No, but Mrs. Matthews, me head teacher.
Oh, sure. Let's not lay into Matthews again. She's always getting
into not Matty Matthews. Not Grimble Matty Matthews.
I'd never be a high flyer.
If she could see you now. What did she say? You'll never be a high flyer?
She said that to me, mum and dad.
Really?
On a parents' evening.
That
was after I'd played the drums in Little Donkey.
She clearly didn't know what she was talking about. The pinch of salt.
REM with Orange Crush on XFM 104.9. Well, nearly 20 minutes to go. I'm Ricky Gervais, with me Steve and Carl. Carl, what did you point to me then?
Just now reminded me.
Go on.
Orange Crush. Do you know we were talking the other night about contraceptives?
No, you said to me, I've got to do lots of homework. You look up how they used, in the olden days, how they used to use elephant dung as a contraceptive. And I went, what? And he went, no, look it up. You make me give me those things. I said, I don't know. Was it they put, when you're running around with dung on the end of your knob, no woman really wants to go near you. Is that how it worked? And he went, come on, you give me things to do.
If you've just written a PhD on how to use elephant dung as a contraceptive, please get in touch.
And
I'll give the number in a minute.
It's not elephant, it was crocodile.
Oh.
Why?
But, yeah, orange.
Sorry,
crush.
No, you can't. No, whoa.
What?
Back. What do you mean? It was crocodile dung. What, how did they use crocodile dung as a contraceptive?
I don't know.
Right, go on, Orange Crush, yeah.
So Orange Crush, what it was, I was trying to look up that thing about crocodile stuff, using it, and I came up with another one saying that they used to use a lemon, sort of shaped, right, and the put it on, and the citric. Is that the
citric acid
in it
would kill the sperm. Right.
So they would, sorry, they would wear the lemon on the end of the knob.
Was that erotic?
It worked.
Listen, I'll try anything, Carl, mate. That works.
Yeah.
If the ladies like that. I mean, could it be anything? Could it be like, you know, a melon?
Kumquat?
Yeah, maybe. In my case.
What's those hairy ones?
Yeah.
Anyway, it just reminded me when Orange Crush.
Well, thanks very much for that, Carl. It's, And that, I didn't even ask him to
research
that.
No. So Orange Crush reminded you of the lemon contraceptive?
Mm.
Okay. Jolly good.
Use it as a little lemon squeezer, couldn't you? It could be like a novelty lemon squeezer. You just stand in the kitchen, and then when someone wants to just come along and go, on the end of your...
Did you make this lemonade yourself?
Yes, I did. It tastes funny. Anyway.
Carl, this is a quick question to you. Would you ever sort of find yourself in a situation where you might confuse a woman's breasts with mountains? Is that a concern for you, do you think?
No.
Not a problem for you?
Well, not if they're small and humble, I wouldn't.
That's what I'm hoping. That's what, fingers crossed.
If they were small and humble, then I'd pretty much not confuse them with mountains.
Thank God. But I mean, if they were large and sort of pendulous.
And with, like quite rocky with snow on top.
Exactly.
Then I'd go, hold on, love.
Wait a minute.
Hold on, love. I was into this, but now.
Exactly.
I feel like I'm alone.
Carl, do you know what we're talking about?
Who has done that?
I'll give you a clue. One more time. See, my breasts are small and humble, so you don't confuse them with mountains. Shakira. It's a lyric that
taking
means
the nation by
with.
Storm.
It's quite a nice song. It's got another.
It's very much like. It sounds a bit like Men at Work Down Under.
Yeah, it's got the pan pipes.
Is this what's its kid?
Who?
Julio Iglesias.
No, it's Shakira. Consequently, the word Shakira there being mentioned.
I haven't heard of him.
Okay. She's a big Latin star, apparently, big Latin American star.
Yeah.
And, anyway, just sing it again for us.
See, my breasts are small and humble, so you don't confuse them with mountains. Which is a concern, it was always a concern.
Definitely.
Actually, the number of times she's woken up, and there's been a fat bloke with a beard and a little Sherpa, she goes, what are you doing? And they go, we're just trying to climb this mountain. Look again! Oh, sorry, love.
Oh, it's your tits, I didn't realise.
Oh, tits, we thought we were in...
I can't believe it.
I can't. Well, can we camp? If you can't camp on my tits for the night, no.
Well, why are you climbing them?
Well, I just
because they
confused.
Were there.
Well, they're small and humble. What, are you mental? Look at Carl. I love that look of Carl. Carl is looking back and forth. You know when you sort of you go to a cat and it looks back and forth between two people. That's very much like Carl's looking at us now.
Or when like a child sees a midget or something in the street. They're just transfixed, aren't they? And the parents just don't stare.
When we were pushing Ash, yesterday, our producer's in a wheelchair, and we were pushing
him
through
the VC. He's not a midget, we should
make that. No, he's not a little midget, he's not tall. But we were pushing him through the VC, and this little kid just came up and just stood in front of him and looked at him.
Yeah.
I just laughed.
It was funny. Do you do that? I imagine that you get caught staring at
him. Yeah, do you go up to people? Do you go up to people with problems and go, Mummy, is that a monster?
Well, I was telling you one about when I used to go with my dad in the taxi.
Oh, yeah. Well, tell us this story.
Well,
Your father was a taxi driver?
My dad, he had loads of jobs, which he did back then. And they don't do that anymore, do they, people? They don't
have a variety
loads
of
stuff.
Sure.
But at one point, he had a black cab, and I used to used to go with him, used to get a, like a beer crate and put it in the front of the black cab. Ooh, and sort of sit just next to the meter. And anyway, we got this call, and like the guy on the end of the radio said, "Oh, you've got your son with you, haven't you?" So he said, "Yeah." So it's just like, you know, we've got a pick up at number 11 Village Lane or whatever. And he said, "Oh, all right." And it was this woman. It was like a woman version of the Elephant Man.
Wow, the Elephant Woman.
Yeah, it looked like. It was really strange because I was in the front of the cab, and when you're a kid, if something looks odd, you're a bit scared of it, aren't you?
Yeah.
And my dad was like, "Look, it'll be all right." And we're driving towards her.
Don't worry, son, I've got loads of buns.
And just to
I think I'll just throw one down the street if you run after it.
You're being mean, right?
How old were you, 18?
No, I was about 12 or sure. something like that, 11, 12. Hmm. And as we got closer to her, it looked like she was holding, like, a bag of spuds on her shoulder.
For a snack.
Right.
And her head was all a bit mangled and messy and that. And my dad said, "Whatever you do, don't stare at her face."
Yeah.
And she got in the back.
Because you turn into stone.
Well, she got in the back, and I had, like, the mirror, the driver's mirror thing, yeah. And sort of having a look, trying to work out. And he said, "Don't stare at her face." I couldn't work out where her face was. It was that weird.
Oh, God.
So I'm not sure you're from Manchester. I think you're from, like, Narnia or something.
Yeah, you got frog boys walking around.
The Lord of the Rings.
That got, like, the claws of a lobster and the head of a toad.
Yeah.
And you got women getting in with spuds for heads. I mean, what is this place?
This is not the place you grew up. This is mad.
You can't believe it in London, can you? You come down and you go, "Look, symmetry. It must be amazing."
It must be a thing to do with upbringing, though, mustn't it? Because, again, do you know, I've said to you before, years ago, when I was a kid and didn't have any worries, good-looking lad, you go through it a bit. Have a few more worries, and you look knackered. Now, back there's a lot more worries and stuff, so you get a lot more freaks. Whereas in London, everyone's, like, happy, aren't they?
I love the fact that stress can cause your fingers to fuse and your head to grow.
No, but if
she must have been really stressed to have a head like
She was she an accountant or something?
Wow. You know what I mean?
But what did she do? What did she say?
Where was she going, by the way?
She couldn't speak.
London Zoo, please.
She was going to, like,
to
a
the
pet
fair.
Shop. Seriously, honest to God. On my mum's life, she was. Because at the end of the day, that's a good thing with animals. They don't judge you, do they?
She's not an animal.
She's a human being.
She's not actually an elephant.
No, but she...
You know the Elephant Man was not actually an elephant. Do you understand that? He's got no elephant genes in him at all.
No.
That was just a cruel name people gave him.
Yeah.
No, it's the name of the disease, isn't it? Elephantitis.
So this woman, why was she going to a pet shop?
She was going to a pet shop. What, to find her husband?
Is this true?
No, it is true, yeah.
Oh, God.
I'm not taking the mickey, because it must be really bad for
you. Of course it is.
Carl,
I'm going on to you today about cutting myself shaving.
Yeah.
I was going on about that. To think that she... I mean, she's probably not alive now. But to think...
But you're going to say this is a worse problem than a little cut shaving, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
There's a couple of key questions I need to ask. One, if she couldn't talk, how did she tell your father where to drive it? Did she have it written on a note?
Did she point with her nose?
Yeah.
Right, this has got silly. Pick your song.
But and also, finally, where did you say she lived again?
It was like in a village. A little small village.
Right.
Just heading out of the way.
All I'm saying is we could maybe get like some sort of coach, book some coaches, get a coach party out there to have a look at her.
And now
you can make some lemonade.
The offspring of a woman and some spuds.
Yeah.
Please enter at your peril. Shit, give me a shiny shilling. Wow. Oh, that's terrible. Well, I'm going to play a little bit of Teenage Fan Club song for the lovers here. We left it very late. We've been just rapping with Karl P here, and this is I Need Direction. Teenage Fan Club. Oh, they're a good band.
They are a good band.
XFM 104.9. We're nearly there. So will your girlfriend be proud of you now? You performed a PhD graduate there.
It's a bit annoying because she's not in London today. She's in Sunderland or something, or Newcastle.
Right.
Working.
So she won't know what your greatest triumph. She saw last week's and you got an E in history, and now this week you come through with some great praise that Mrs. Matthews never... you know, laid upon you, did she? No, just said you won't be a high flyer. Eh? You've shown them, haven't you?
You never know. I mean, I had mates who, like, you know, my mate Colin Makin, who did the disco with me. Pilkin's making music.
Yeah.
He was dead brainy. I don't think he's up to much these days.
Sure.
You can't plan it.
Yeah.
Just goes to show.
Well, I mean, you can do a certain amount of planning you can do. I mean, driving a tank down to the shops with some fags, never going to mean you're a high flyer.
You know? And that woman who you picked up in your black cab, she's in a circus now and she can fly, which is good. Oh, I'm confusing that with a film. You went to see a film this week, didn't you?
Mm.
What did you see?
Monsters, Inc.
Oh, did you have a little argument? What was the argument about? Did you have an argument with your girlfriend or something? Cause about...
Well, the history thing took over last weekend, to be honest, when you found out my results. That was like the talking topic of most of the weekend. And
why? What did she say?
You know, you brought it on yourself. You know, why didn't you take it serious, you know?
Was she annoyed or upset?
Well, she just sort of said, you can learn. Look, you learned Rasputin.
Mm.
You know, if only you did
you've
that
done that. You've done Rasputin.
Do you know what I mean? She said, you can do it. If you're told to. She said, you know, it's only because Ricky's told you to read the book that you're reading it.
Mm.
Does she think we're sort of like taskmasters?
Does she think we bully you?
Nah, she knows it's just a laugh.
Yeah. What did you tell your parents about your...
Nope.
No. Never?
Because they never even questioned where my results were, so I don't want to tell them that, you know, I didn't get any.
No. What? How did they do it at school?
I didn't have them back then, did they?
Right. when was that called? The Middle Ages.
I don't know. I mean, like I say, back then it wasn't about getting results and that, was it? It was just about learning trades. Mm. I mean, my dad, right, he can, like, put windows in his house.
Yeah.
Do plumbing.
He should. It's dark, isn't it? He's done that, first of all. Right.
So he can do what? He's got a multitude of different jobs?
Yeah, he can do all sorts. Do you know what I mean? Mm. If there's a problem in my flat, I can call him up and say, you know, this isn't working, what should I do?
Mm.
And he'll say, like...
Is that our brain surgeon?
He'll say, he'll fix it.
Sure. So what about Monsters, Inc.? What did you make of it?
So, all right, it is a kid's film. It sort of annoyed
me. Is it?
Okay.
I was having, like...
what gave that away, do you think? Was it the songs? Was it the animation?
Yeah, the fluffy little things that squiggled round on the screen for an hour and a half.
It is annoying because, like, there's kids everywhere and kids don't watch films, do they?
No.
Do you know what I mean? They're messing
around. I don't know why they make kids' films, and you can't, to be honest. It's mental.
Can't concentrate properly when you've got kids, you know, making noise around you and that. Yeah. So I'd say, my little review, wait until it comes out on DVD.
Okay. What a great review that would be! Wouldn't that be great? Film 2002.
Yeah.
Jonathan Ross going... Well, I don't want to give it away until it comes out on DVD. Yeah. Oh.
No, but not giving it away, it's just that you can't watch it properly when there's kids screaming around you.
Yeah.
Sure.
Do you know what I mean?
What are you looking forward to this week? You going to go and see anything?
Just been talking to Ricky now, because my missus is away. I'll probably get out a DVD tonight.
Yep.
Rounders.
Oh, right, okay.
I thought you might like that.
And if
like
you can get, I mean, if I can get you tickets, say, in the stalls or in a box for the stage version of Midnight Express, would you be up for that?
it's on ice.
I think it's the final year, isn't it?
It's lovely. It's Midnight Express on ice.
Yeah.
And it's a musical as well.
They're on roller skates.
Do you have any dope under your jacket? No.
Yeah. It's
great. John Hurt is actually in this version as well, which is fantastic. He played the Elephant Man. So it's all comes, the universe all comes together.
Have you ever seen the stage version of the Elephant Man?
No.
You'd love that?
Yeah. Who's in that? I have seen a clip of it. Who plays him?
I think they got a real guy with elephantitis.
Right.
Yeah.
What are you finishing on?
Let's have a final song for the ladies. It's from the album Kiss Me, Kiss Me, Kiss Me by The Cure. And it's The Beautiful Catch.
Goodbye. See you next week, everybody. Bye-bye.